Well, thank you very much, John. It's a tremendous honor for me to have this opportunity to talk to the ICE, but also to have the honor of an award carrying the name of Sir Vincent Wigglesworth. It's really quite an extraordinary moment in my career, and I'm grateful to John and his colleagues. I also want to echo what John said and thank Walter and Alvin and others in the ICE Council. This has been a wonderful meeting. It's truly extraordinary. So I hope I can sustain your interest as the rest of the meeting has done. I'm going to be talking tonight, as John mentioned, about the sense of smell in insects. And it's going to be an overview from 10,000 feet of a lot of work that's gone on in my group over the years, with some reference to work of others. I apologize to those of you who are specialists in this field, because this is a talk aimed at everybody and not just the specialists. But I hope there'll be something to amuse everyone here. So we're going to be talking about the sense of smell. And I'd like to start, though, by paying homage to Sir Vincent. I had the great honor of meeting him just once in, I think, 1974. I was visiting Cambridge, and John Traherne, who had become the director of the unit that Sir Vincent had established many years earlier, took me to the tea room in the zoology building, and Sir Vincent came in for tea. So I had the opportunity to meet him. He was about as cheerful as he looks in these pictures. And as John told you, though, he was a consummate experimental entomologist. He was renowned for his simple but elegant experiments, which he conducted right until his 10th decade, an amazing career. But to give you a little flavor for what it must have been like to be with him regularly, and before I move on, I want to read just one little section from a recent article in The Antenna, which is the Royal Entomological Society's magazine. This is now referring to meetings of the Royal Entomological Society about 50 years earlier. Seeing the legendary figures in battle was a major draw for attending the meetings. One could also see and hear Sir Vincent Wigglesworth of Cambridge University. He had a cutting edge to his comments, so sharp that people would avoid a thrust in their direction. He was therefore rarely challenged after he had spoken, and accordingly tended to have the last word in any discussion. I kind of envy him for having the last word. Anyhow, he was amazing, and John has mentioned already what he's most known for. I first encountered his very famous book on the principles of insect physiology, was my primer in the field, a book that by the time I saw it was an advanced edition, but he wrote the first edition in 1939 and basically was the father of the field of insect physiology and, as John said, endocrinology in particular. So it's really a wonderful occasion for our Congress to remember him. Now, I first heard about sex pheromones and chemical communication when I was a freshman in university, first-year university student, the year after the word pheromone was first coined. I had gone to college to be a music major, but I took a biology course in my first year that changed my whole life trajectory. And for those in the audience who are young, I can't really see how many students are here. I just want to tell you that this is a great example of how we don't know what we're doing at any one moment. I had thought all my life up to that point that I would end up being a musician, and within 6 months of my first year in university, I had decided to become a scientist. But fortunately, I had encountered some faculty who were interested in insects and pointed me to Carlson's paper in which the word pheromone was first coined, and Boutonnant's amazing study in which the first pheromone component was chemically identified in a truly Herculean effort. If you've never read about that, you should. So I got really interested, even before I knew much about biology or chemistry, in this business of chemical communication. Some years later, when I was really serious about the field, I discovered Dietrich Schneider's paper in Science, which I think was a really foundational paper on the sense of smell in insects. It's not that others hadn't thought about it before, but that really lit the field on fire. And it's been burning more and more brightly ever since. So this was an early interest, but it took a long time for me to really bring it to a coalescence in my own life, because I never studied entomology in my whole education. It came about later, but the interest was there. Now, what really got me into the field that I'm going to be talking about tonight is my encounter in 1965, when I was a graduate student, with this little book. The image on top here is what the original book looked like. This was Kenneth Roeder's little book called Nerve Cells and Insect Behavior, and it was an epiphany for me. I read the whole book in one sitting, and when I put it back on the new bookshelf in the library, by the way, a library for the young people here is a big building full of books. I knew when I put that book back on the new bookshelf that that's what I wanted to do. But I had to finish my Ph.D. on the bioorganic chemistry of enzyme reactions in bacteria before I could do it. Anyhow, I'm very much indebted to Ken Roeder and his inspiration. Now, in talking about insect olfaction, I want to lay the groundwork before getting into our own work. I had the good fortune, after I had just started to work in this field, to meet Dietrich Schneider. He, as I said, wrote the science paper in 1969, and he had established a group in the Max Planck Institute for Behavioral Physiology and Savies, and that was really the world's leading group at that time in the field of insect olfaction, particularly with respect to moth pheromone communication. They did their work on silk moths, as you can see in the slide, but that group, every one of them was a pioneer in his subfields. Particularly, Karl-Heinz Keisling was a physiologist and biophysicist who really did pioneering work on how odor molecules are transduced by receptor cells in antennae, long before we knew about the molecular basis for that. And these people became my teachers, my inspiration, my family. For many years, I went to ZVs and every chance I got. So I really want to remember Dietrich Schneider here and his colleagues, who really did fantastic work and I think laid the groundwork for what all the rest of us do now in insect olfaction. Now, my work, the work of my group, focuses on the functional organization, post-embryonic development, physiology, and behavioral roles of the insect olfactory system, and as you'll see, particularly in a moth. And unlike most people working in this field, particularly in the field as it is now, very strongly developing, I don't work on transduction and olfactory receptor cells, I work on the brain. So we're going to be talking about the brain tonight. But in order to do that, with the techniques that were available then, and which I still believe are very powerful methods, we had to have a big insect. We needed an insect that was large, that had neural circuitry and nerve cells that were accessible to the techniques that I'll show you tonight. We wanted it to have the advantage of an invertebrate, you know, identifiable neural elements and relative simplicity, at least numerical simplicity. And I have to confess that in choosing this model organism, my goal was to learn about olfaction in general through the study of a tractable organism. It's my real passion for insects developed slowly after that. And on I could go in this list of criteria. Well, I didn't know entomology, so I went to somebody that I knew really well and asked for advice. That was Fotis Kafatos. I think some of you may know Fotis or know of him. It, just as cheerful as he looks there. When I asked him what I wanted, he got that same look on his face, and he took me down the hall to a lab room and reached in an incubator, and he pulled out a caterpillar the size of a large Cuban cigar, and he said, "That's what you want." That was Manduca sexta, a fifth instar caterpillar. Well, I asked him if I could have some to take back to my lab, which was in another part of the university, and he said, well, he didn't have many of them because he was working on flies, so he said, go to the basement, the sub-basement of the bio building, and look for Jim Truman and Lynn Ritterford and Carol Williams' group. So I went down there, and Jim Truman, my first encounter with him, and I think it was 1971, he gave me my first Manduca, which were a revelation. I took them back to the lab and carved into them and looked at the ganglia and the nerve cord, and I could see with a dissecting scope big cell bodies of nerve cells. That's what I want. That's my animal. And for all the years since then, 45 years, Manduka's been paying my breakfast bills. So I'm grateful to Fotis and Jim very much for their support in that early activity. Now, as most of you surely know, this is Manduka. It's a big sphingid, wonderfully tractable, easy to rear in the lab, has very big, the brain of Manduka is bigger than a whole Drosophila. It's a fantastic animal. And it's proven to have all the attributes that I had sought. So I have good reason to have stayed with it all these years. Moreover, as I'll be showing you, it has behaviors typical of moths, very dependent on olfaction. So it gives us the opportunity to do behaviorally relevant work on the neural elements underlying the behavior. Now, the central question that has really been on my mind all through those years is that we want to understand how central coding, that is central neural processing of behaviorally significant olfactory stimuli, mixtures typically, almost all naturally significant odor stimuli are mixtures, how those are processed to generate or initiate or sustain the behaviors for which they're responsible. So this little cartoon shows a Manduka trying to figure out if all those volatiles it's getting are coming from its preferred host plant flower in the Sonoran Desert where I live, Datura redii. And we'll talk about that in a few minutes. So our approach all along has been very integrative and multidisciplinary. I was trained as a biologist and a chemist before I had anything to do with insects, and I had loved natural history and behavior, so I wanted to work at the interface of those things. So when I talk about our work, I'm going to be saying about telling you about things that happened there. And I'll also be saying we, but I have to admit right now who we are. This is a large roster of people who really are responsible for the fact that I have this honor tonight. They wouldn't all fit on this stage, or they really should be here, because the work I'll tell you about really has had major contributions from most of the people on that list, and it's been the biggest single honor of my career to have such wonderful co-workers, both my immediate co-workers and my collaborators, also shown on this slide. Now, I'm going to show you in the next slide, highlighted in yellow, the people who had the major contributions to the topics I'll discuss tonight. But again, for those who are in the audience, and several of them are here, I just want to say what a joy it has been to work with you all. Okay, so when I say we, I mean they. Now, olfaction in adult Manduka, let's get to that. If you look at the antennae, the principal olfactory organs of this moth, you can see right away, even if you're a molecular biologist, that they're sexually dimorphic. That was a joke, by the way. I know it's late in the day. The male antenna looks thicker and heavier than the female's antenna, and the reason for that is shown here. The male antenna has long scincilla that are missing on the female's antenna, and we'll talk about those long trichoid scincilla as we go further into the topic tonight. Among the structures that emanate from the antennal flagellum are peg-like structures and hair-like structures that you can see there. These are all scincilla, and to generalize, they're structures that are cuticular extensions that have some number of sensory nerve cells, the olfactory receptor cells, innervating them, sending receptor cilia up into the lumen of the peg or the hair. That's the receptive part of the receptor cell. The cell bodies are here. There are other cells that make up the rest of the sensillum that produce this fluid that bathes the receptor cilia and so forth. And then the nerve cells that you see here in green, they send their axons from the antenna through the antennal nerve that you'll see in a minute into the brain. And then that's where our business begins. So what happens here is transduction of odor molecules into neural activity. That is a huge industry now, studying that business, mainly today in Drosophila with very powerful molecular and genetic tools, but also in many other taxa. That became a big industry starting about 25 years ago with the discovery of the big gene family in mammals that encodes olfactory receptor proteins that won a Nobel Prize for Buck and Axel. Then about 10 years after that, many people, led first by John Carlson and Leslie Vossall and a few others, started to find the corresponding genes in insects. And now many insect taxa are being studied to look at their olfactory receptors and to characterize the ligands to which they respond and so forth. This is a big business, and it's really an elegant set of studies that account for the first step in olfactory information processing. But it's the last thing the odor molecules do is to activate selectively this or that olfactory receptor cell. And after that, it's all a matter of neurobiology, and that's what we're gonna talk about tonight. Now, what happens in the antennae up here is, as I said, transduction into electrical activity. That's carried by axons of the receptor cells that pass through this nerve into the anteriormost structure in the brain, which is called the antennal or olfactory lobe of the brain. Here you see the real thing. This is the antennal nerve here. You can see stained in black is essentially all of the olfactory receptor axons in that antennal nerve. And this is just in a section, so you can see a lot of them even in one section. And you can see that they up here look more or less parallel. Then there's some chaotic thing happens here, they start crossing. And finally you see bundles or fascicles of axons projecting out of this chaotic zone and into ball-shaped structures, very clearly here and here. Those are called the olfactory glomeruli. It's been known since the 19th century that the olfactory center in the brain of essentially every metazoan that has an olfactory system is characterized by these condensed neuropil knots that are called glomeruli. There are very few exceptions to that. And here you can see that olfactory receptor axons project from the antenna into glomeruli. You can't see, we can't tell from this, what the rules are for projection, but you can see that that's where they're going. Now, in passing, I just want to mention something interesting about this chaotic looking zone here. We call that the sorting zone, and the reason we call it that will become clear now in this cartoon. Here you have olfactory receptor cells up in the antenna, up in the flagellum, in the sensilla of the flagellum, and then we've used colors to indicate different receptor phenotypes, that is, cells expressing different olfactory receptor proteins, so endowing each cell with its responsive profile. So you've got ones that smell red things, one that smell green things, and so forth. Well, they send their axons through the antennal nerve in a pattern that's somatotopic, that is, they come parallel, all parallel with each other down through the antennal nerve, organized according to where they came from on the antenna. But all of a sudden, when they get to the sorting zone, during development, they encounter a population of very remarkable glial cells. These glial cells have migrated out from the developing antennal lobe and sit there at the entry to the antennal lobe. As I said, right here, just where the axons are entering the antennal lobe. And those glial cells oversee reorganization or sorting of the axons so that what emerges from that sorting zone are now fascicles of axons of like tuning. So all the blue responsive axons go to a single glomerulus, and all the red responsive axons go to a red glomerulus, and so forth. This principle was first demonstrated conclusively in insects, but it's now known to be the principle that governs the organization of olfactory pathways in mammals like you and me, and many other creatures, fish and birds, you name it. So those glomeruli can be thought of as mailboxes that are receiving input from one segment of the olfactory world determined by the response characteristics of the receptor cells that project into that mailbox. So this is kind of categorizing odorants according to some rules that are characteristic for that species. Okay, now looking at an expanded cartoon, again we have the head with the brain, the antennal lobe, and down here are cartoons of the antennal lobes of males and females. This is in Manduka, but it's not terribly different from many other moth species. In both males, females and males, there are 63 glomeruli. These are identified neuropil structures, and in other insects now, there are many examples where all the glomeruli are also identified. That's a huge advantage. There's no vertebrate animal where you can say that all of the glomeruli are identified and can be studied in animal after animal reliably, but we can do that in several insect species now. And that's very advantageous experimentally, as you can imagine. Now, So there are 63 glomeruli. They receive input from about 350,000 olfactory receptor cells along the antenna. So there's a huge convergence of receptor cell axons onto glomeruli, very similar to the convergence virology in our olfactory system. And then processing that input are cells that have their cell bodies in a lateral group, a medial group, and a very small anterior group that isn't shown here. They add up to about 1,200 central neurons innervating those glomeruli and receiving and processing input from the olfactory receptor cells. So all of that numerology is kind of similar to the ratios that we show and mice show and so forth. So it's a general principle, probably has been around a long time in evolution as a general principle. But here we have a system which has proven to be quite tractable for understanding what's going on in glomeruli, why are they important. Now, in addition to 60 sexually isomorphic glomeruli shown in green that are the same as far as we can tell in males and females, each of those two genders has three sexually specific or sexually dimorphic glomeruli. There are three female glomeruli. Two of them we call the large female glomeruli, pretty imaginative name, and this S glomerulus. Those are the three that are female specific. And in males, there are three male specific glomeruli shown in red. Two of them are bagel or donut shaped. These two here, so we call them toroids, the first and second toroid. And the third one is this multi-lobed thing up here that looks like a puffy white cloud. So 40 years ago, we named it the cumulus, just because of what it looked like. Those three big, interestingly shaped male-specific glomeruli will be something I'll talk about in a few minutes. And I'll say something also about one of the lateral, the large female glomeruli, this one right here. I'll tell you about that when we get there. So this is the general layout summarized in this cartoon. I'll just give you one example of an identified glomerulus. Pablo Gerenstein, who was a postdoc in the lab some years ago, he showed that a glomerulus down here at 6 o'clock in both males and females is the site of processing of carbon dioxide, which is an odorant for insects, as I'm sure most of you know. As in bloodsuckers, where CO2 is very important in their orientation to and propensity to feed from a host, here carbon dioxide, we know, thanks to Pablo's work and the work of others in the lab, is important for nectar feeding from flowers. So CO2 seems to have a kind of a leitmotif of being involved in feeding behavior. So that's one example of a narrowly tuned specific glomerulus of known function. Now there are two main cell types, neuronal cell types in the antenna lobe. There are actually many variations on the theme, but I'm just gonna talk about the big picture. One of them is a so-called stellate cell that you see here. My favorite looking cell, I think they're gorgeous. These stellate means star-like, and it's a term that neuroscientists use to describe cells like this. It's also what we call an amacrine cell. It doesn't send a neural process or axon out of the antenna lobe. The cell is confined to the antenna lobe. And as you see in the typical invertebrate pattern, there's a cell body here, a first order neurite that comes out of the cell body, and then this wonderful radial expansion of the cell to various dendritic compartments that ramify throughout the antenna lobe. In fact, that cell innervates every glomerulus in that female antenna lobe. The other principal cell type is shown here. This is called a principal cell or projection neuron. This is one of the commonest kinds of projection neurons. It's a uniglomerular one, so it has its arborizations in a single glomerulus. Its cell body, in this case, is in the medial cell group, and it sends an axon out of the antenna lobe downstream to higher order olfactory centers in the brain. Now, you can imagine if you stand right here and listen to the activity in that cell, it's a way of eavesdropping on what has happened in synaptic processing at the level of that glomerulus. So we've spent a lot of time in the last 40 years doing just that, and I'll show you how we do that. Now, Carolina Reisenmann, who's somewhere in the audience here, was a wonderful neurophysiologist in our lab for many years. This is one of her beautiful preparations. This is a preparation which she recorded from and then injected dye into an individual projection neuron. You can see it there, classic example. And then in the same preparation, in a sequential part of the experiment, she impaled and recorded from another cell, which happened to be one of those beautiful local interneurons. So it shows you the relationship between the two, and it so happens, typically, in this experiment, that red local neuron was an inhibitory neuron that made inhibitory synaptic connections with that projection neuron. So good on you, Carolina. It's a good preparation. I'd like to show it. Okay, now, I'd like to give an example of characterization of a glomerulus. I told you about Pablo's experiment. I didn't show you what he did. Here's another story from Carolina. This is Carolina down here. Maybe hard to see. But so here's an antennal lobe of a female moth. And there's the two large female glomeruli, the LFGs. And this one is called the lateral LFG. Carolina recorded from many neurons innervating that glomerulus in a set of experiments that she did. And here's one of those cells, dye-injected after recording from it. So you can see the cell. You can see exactly how it projects. It leaves the antennal lobe here and projects back into the protocerebrum. That cell, when she recorded from it, was responsive very selectively to linalool. By responsive, I mean not the cell directly, but she stimulated the antenna with linalool, and then input from the antennal receptor cells onto that cell drove the cell, and it was powerfully driven by linalool. Now, linalool is a racemic, she used racemic linalool. It's an enantiomeric substance, as most of you know. And the question then that came to mind is, can these cells tell the difference between the enantiomers? There wasn't much of anything in the literature about that kind of question, but we were curious about it. So Carolina proceeded then to test the plus and minus enantiomers. And it turns out that, to our surprise, this cell was very powerfully selective for the plus enantiomer of linalool. That's the less common of the two enantiomers, if you look at plant sources. There's quite a story that developed from that. But I want to show that one of the ways that selectivity can occur is not just from one substance to another, but even enantiomers can be selectively detected by receptor cells and then reflected in the responsiveness of central neurons. So that's kind of how we proceed to identify the what's going on in individual glomeruli. So we can say that there are specific plant volatiles that are involved in stimulating inputs to the female-specific glomeruli. And in the male-specific glomeruli, as you may have guessed, it's a sex pheromone processing region. So we're going to talk about that quite a bit in a few minutes. Now, I'm not going to dwell on this, but for the neurobiologists in the audience and maybe others, it might be interesting to know that through lots of work of the kind that I've just mentioned, but using tools that I haven't described, one can start to work out wiring relationships among neural elements. So we have a pretty good emerging idea about the synaptic circuitry in individual glomeruli that involves not only the inputs from the antenna, but various kinds of synaptic relationships between those inputs and projection neurons and those wide-field local interneurons. In Manduca, the wide-field local interneurons are all or nearly all inhibitory neurons. We have only once in 40-some years actually conclusively detected one that was excitatory. So there's at least one, maybe. But if you look at other insect taxa, there's evidence for much more excitatory activity of local interneurons. So this isn't a subject where we learn from one taxon how all taxa work, and I'm going to come back to that at the end. I just want to mention it now to give you an advance warning. The other thing that's interesting about this is that the local neurons, as you saw, branching everywhere in the antennal lobe, they have the potential to link glomeruli. They not only have activity, in our case, inhibitory effects within glomeruli, but also between glomeruli, and I'm going to get back to that a little later, too. Okay, now, I've already mentioned that moths like Manduca have very beautiful behaviors that are olfaction-dependent. I'll just give you the three examples that have been of interest to us, and they won't surprise anyone in the audience. The first is this one, in which a female is laying an egg on a host plant, happens to be a tobacco plant. Manduca sexta is specialized to solanaceous plants. And it's interesting to note that, unlike the story with some other Lepidoptera, Manduca sexta seems to make the assessment that it's a host plant before she even touches the plant. As far as we can tell in our experiments, this is an olfactory decision. And I haven't got time to describe the evidence for that, but it's really a very strong case that she doesn't have to contact the plant to know that it's a host plant. Touching the plant is important for getting her to complete the business of laying an egg, but not for selecting the plant. So she's assessing it from the volatiles in the headspace over the plant. That's overposition behavior. Foraging and nectar feeding is another behavior of great interest to us. Obviously, these beautiful flowers, this is the Datura wrightii that is one of the main host plants in the Sonoran Desert where we live, they see them, but they don't see them clearly until they're pretty close, 18 inches or so away from the flower, because they're out at night when it's pretty dark. And the insect visual system just doesn't work very well at a big distance. So they orient to these flowers from a distance using olfaction, and they only use vision when they get close and to track the flower as it moves in the breeze so that they can suck nectar from it and not lose track of the flower. Interestingly enough, they not only feed on nectar, but they transfer pollen in the process. So they're important pollinators. They are the important pollinators for this plant. So that's another important model, if you will, behavior that has been of great interest to us. And then finally, as I've already prepared you for, we've been very interested in mate location. Here's a male moth approaching a female who's calling, and he has oriented from a distance based on the sex pheromone plume that has emanated from her. And I'll now talk about that topic for a while, because it's been the window on which we've learned a lot of principles of olfactory function that turn out to be pretty good predictors of how other olfactory processes occur. The pheromone story is a kind of a little keyhole through which to view a big universe in this animal. Now, my little app isn't working. Oh, pity. Okay, well, what you would see, this is Ring Cardet's little app where this is supposed to spin out a plume from a point source. It's really quite nice because it shows something important. Anyway, it's meant to show what the plume coming from a female looks like if you could actually see it. Many of you probably know this, but it turns out that the plume is not a fog of molecules. It's not a concentration gradient. It's an envelope of filaments that spin off of the source in the moving airstream so that the plume is actually discontinuous. And when a male moth intersects the plume, oops. Okay, maybe I'll show that. So when the male moth enters the plume, contacts the plume, he receives intermittent or discontinuous stimulation. We've symbolized the filaments of pheromone in the plume as these little yellow symbols. So his antennae are receiving pulses of pheromone when he's in contact with the plume. The behavior that results from that has been beautifully studied, not only by Ring Cardet, but also Tom Baker and Wendell Roloffs and many other people. I can't list all the people who've contributed to that. They've been real pioneers. And the story is very nice and very, very beautifully characterized so that people like me benefit from what they've done. It's clear that the moth, as long as it's receiving these discontinuous pulses of pheromone, sustains upwind or anemotactic flight, surging forward with each pulse of pheromone. If the moth loses the plume, it casts until it recontacts the plume. And the story is quite nice. I mean, you can see that they can trace the plume allegedly over great distances. Manduka is an amazingly powerful flyer, arguably one of the most powerful flyers of all insects. And it's been claimed that they go tens, if not hundreds of kilometers in a single night. So my guess is that they detect pheromone plumes at big distances from calling females. And it's dark out, they can't see them. So they orient, as you see in this slide, up the pheromone plume, looking for the unseen source of this attractant, because they have just one thing on their little minds when they're doing that. What is the pheromone of Manduka? Well, thanks to Carl Dahm first, and then Jim Tumlinson and his coworkers, they figured out what the pheromone is. Carl Dahm originally showed that bombical is the predominant component. We just call that here component A. And then Jim Tumlinson and his team, over quite a few years, did the very difficult job of identifying that triene aldehyde that you see there. It's also a 16-carbon triene aldehyde. In fact, there are two 16-carbon triene aldehydes in the blend that comes off of the pheromone gland. And in total, there are eight 16-carbon aldehydes that Tumlinson's team found. which give in field trapping tests maximal trap catches. But what we found is that for the upwind distance-oriented flight, this behavior, just two components are necessary and sufficient, and those are the two compounds you see there. We'll just call them A and B for tonight, and they're in a ratio roughly 2-to-1 in the pheromone mixture. What the other components are doing that enhances the trap catch isn't quite clear, although there probably are short distance effects that nobody yet has really studied as far as I know. But we've just focused on the simplest thing we could find, because odor stimuli typically are mixtures, and you can't have a simpler mixture than two. And so we figured if we can understand how that brain processes a mixture of two, we're in a good pathway to understand how more complicated mixtures may be processed. Okay, so what does the male moth's olfactory system have to do? It has to perform quantitative analysis. It's got qualitative, I should start with. It has to know that the components that are necessary and sufficient are there, these two components, A and B. When the male moth is out there and contacts a plume, right away, he gets excited, he gets activated if the components that are meaningful to him are present. Secondly, he has to do quantitative analysis because the ratio is important. In some moth species, it's very tightly controlled. In Manduca, it's not as critical, but it can't be way off. One of my graduate students, Josh Martin, did some nice studies of varying the proportions of the ratio of the two components and showing that it matters a lot, but not as much as in some species. So it's quantifying the ratio, but it also arguably is making some kind of absolute quantification. And I don't have time to go into that deeper now, but it's happening. Third, because the discontinuities in the plume are important, we know from wind tunnel studies and this and other moths that if you give a fog of the right mixture, the moths don't respond to it behaviorally. They have to have discontinuous stimulation. And that's naturally occurring in that discontinuous plume. Well, how is that represented in the nervous system? How are the intermittent stimuli encoded? And finally, this is the one that interests me the most in recent years. This is how does the odor object, which is the meaningful mixture, how does that get encoded? It isn't just component A and component B. They don't matter. Manduca doesn't show any behavioral response to A or B alone. It has to be that meaningful mixture. That's the odor object that the animals care about. It's a little bit like smelling Chanel No. 5 and then smelling individual components. They don't smell at all like Chanel No. 5. It's not a great analogy, but the mixture is really important, and that's certainly true in these pheromone examples. So those are the tasks that we have to try to account for. Now, in a male moth, those long hairs that you saw, those long trichoid scintilla, look as in this cartoon. They are typically two and occasionally three receptor cells that send their receptor cilia up through the lumen of the hair. And it turns out, in lots of experiments that I'm to describe, we know that one of the two cells is narrowly sensitively tuned to component A and the other to component B. Now, it's pretty convenient that those two are packaged in the same sensory hair because it means that when a filament of the appropriate pheromone mixture hits that hair, the two cells are stimulated simultaneously. Keep that in mind. Now, the axons of those cells extend down through the antennal nerve, as you saw. Here's the antennal nerve. They come down into the antennal lobe, and they terminate in the two biggest glomeruli of the macroglomerular complex, the male-specific glomeruli. The A-specific cells all project to this big toroid, the toroid 1, and the B-specific cells all project to the cumulus. So we have beautiful chemotopy, representation of the two key components of the pheromone that are essential for upwind-oriented flight in the two biggest glomeruli that are unique to male moths. This is one of the earliest clear demonstrations of chemotopy of olfactory glomeruli. Okay, now how do we study the neurons there? Well, we started this, as I said, almost 45 years ago. In those days, there were very limited techniques available, and it turns out that the one we chose and that we've been using ever since, I personally think, to the dismay of my coworkers, because it's difficult, it's the most powerful method you can use. That's sharp electrode intracellular recording. That's a cartoon of a sharp electrode. These are capillary glass pipettes that terminate at their drawn-out tip, less than a micron in diameter, so one can use them like a needle to insert across the membrane of a cell, and connected to electronics, it allows you to measure transmembrane potentials. It also allows you, at the end of the experiment, as badly shown up here, to inject a dye into the cell so that, as you saw already, we can see the cell that we recorded from. We can see not only where it is, but what kind of a cell it is, where is it projecting, and so forth. Other methods don't let you do that, but even more importantly, this has amazing temporal resolution. Again, hold that thought in mind. It's very critical for our experiments. So we use an olfactometry device to deliver pulses of known concentrations, known composition of stimuli to the antenna and record from individual cells one at a time. And doing this over decades, trying to get a picture for how the system is organized and how it works, is a bit like trying to figure out how the Taj Mahal is put together by looking at one brick at a time. But with time, it starts to come into focus. And we, as I've already indicated, we have a pretty good understanding of a lot of the circuitry and how those coding processes are carried out. Now, I just want to show one beautiful example. This was one experiment by a former PhD student, Thomas Heinbuchel, who recorded in the same preparation from two principal or projection neurons innervating the macroglomerular complex. The red one is innervating the cumulus, as you can see, and the green one is a different dye, is innervating the toroid, the first toroid. Now, that isn't artificial color. That's the fluorescence color of the dyes that were injected into the cell. So you see that the cell bodies are here in the medial cell group. The two cells are nicely confined to the two glomeruli, and they send axons pretty parallel downstream to higher order centers. And you'll see where they go later. But he showed very nicely in this intercellular experiment that the red cumulus cell is specifically responding to component B, and the green toroid confined cell is responding to component A, as you'd expect because of what I told you about where the receptor fibers project. So there's no big surprise yet. In fact, in some way, it's almost boring. But it's not so boring because these two cells not only are responding to the inputs to their respective glomeruli, but these types of cells can encode the concentration of the stimulus that's driving the input to them. And they encode that in their instantaneous firing frequency. I don't have time to show you data for that, but it's an important principle in sensory systems, and it's very well shown by these types of cells. So we have a glomerulus that's B-specific and a glomerulus that's A-specific, and the neurons associated with those glomeruli are correspondingly specialized. Now, from this type of experiment, done myriad times by many people in that wonderful team, has led to some generalizations. If we just think about the two big glomeruli here as these cartoon versions, the cumulus and the big toroid, we've got inputs to the big toroid that are all A-specific. We've got inputs to the cumulus that are all B-specific. You just saw a cell like this one, a projection neuron that's driven by component A and responds nicely to component A, and as I said, it encodes concentration and instantaneous firing. You also saw an example of this one, B-specific, not too surprising. But there are also projection neurons that innervate both of these glomeruli. One type is driven by either A or B or the mixture. There aren't many of these cells. We don't know in detail what their function really is behaviorally, but it's not unlikely that they're involved in the arousal phase, which is the very first thing that happens. When a male moth detects pheromone, he revs up his motors. And this is possibly a role for these non-specific A or B cells, they're telling him that there's pheromone around. But the one that's most interesting is this biglomerular projection neuron here that we've labeled blend. This cell is the first cell in the pathway that shows a characteristic response to the mixture of A to B and not to the individual components. And I want to show you that cell because it's pretty cool. I'm not going to show many of these kinds of traces because I know it's tough for non-neurobiologists, but this one's pretty easy to appreciate. Here's the response to the mixture of A plus B. It's what we call an off-on-off response. So the initial part of the response is inhibition, then there's a little burst of activity, and then there's an after period of quiescence. So off-on-off. That's the response to the mixture. The response to the individual components is either excitation or inhibition. You add those two together and you get this nice off on off response. Well, why is that so interesting? Well, it's because of what these cells are capable of doing. Down here, you see responses to 10 pulses of the pheromone mixture per second. So that's like da 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 da. And in fact, I'll show you what it looks like. Watch the dots. That's 10 per second. And you can see that that cell beautifully follows 10 pulses per second. Well, that's right in the middle of the range that a flying male moth detects in a plume. So these cells are beautifully enabled by their response properties to track the discontinuities in the plume, and we knew that there had to be a way in the olfactory pathway to track those discontinuities because they're essential for the behavior to unfold, as I've already explained. So here we've got cells that are doing that. Okay, so what I've shown you is that there are several coding mechanisms that operate in parallel just in these two male-specific glomeruli. There's this sort of spatial coding, which is using the mailboxes of the glomeruli to represent or to gather together information about particular chemistry, that is, the components of the pheromone, the odorants that drive the inputs to those glomeruli. So this is chemical coding. And the glomeruli together, I think of as a chemotopic array. Firing rate, instantaneous firing, as I already said, encodes stimulus intensity, a common principle in sensory systems. And I just showed you how temporal patterning of the firing can be used to encode the spatiotemporal dynamics of the stimulus, the discontinuity, the pulsatile nature of the stimulus. And I've also stressed, and we'll keep doing it, that the message here is the mixture. It's not the individual components. But this doesn't get to the last thing that I said we wanted the male moth system to explain to us. That is, how does the system encode the behavioral significance of the mixture, A plus B, which is this odor object? That is, A in the context of B and B in the context of A. That's been on our minds for a long time. And in the last decade or so, we've worked on that and have some, I think, pretty exciting evidence for a mechanism. Some of you have heard me talk about this before, but it's worth hearing again, maybe. So the question is, when a mixture of volatiles evokes a specific behavior, here upwind and hemotactic flight in response to the pheromone, and its individual components don't evoke that behavior, we call that essential mixture, the odor object, how is it encoded in the pathway? Well, the really key initial experiments that were done by Hong Lei, a wonderful coworker of mine for many years, who's in the audience somewhere, and I'm going to show you just in cartoon version the experiments that kind of gave us the initial insight. The first experiment was one that Hong did where he's recording from a principal or projection neuron from the T glomerulus. So remember, that's going to be responsive to component A. He's got an intracellular electrode. He's recording that as it responds to stimuli in the antennae. What he found was when he stimulated the input to the other glomerulus, he recorded inhibitory synaptic potentials in that cell. Now that's a nice direct demonstration of this lateral inhibitory connection from one glomerulus to the other. We thought that would be present because of the architecture of the inhibitory local interneurons, and it's predicted to be happening, that there'll be lateral inhibition between glomeruli, but here it's a direct demonstration. If you drive the input to this glomerulus and it inhibits the cell over here, as Hong recorded, there's lateral inhibition. The other thing is if he stimulated with the mixture that drives both glomeruli, this gave the response in this cell a more accurate temporal representation of the pulse temp duration. So it enhanced or improved temporal resolution of the stimulus. Now, the really key experiment is this one. In this case, Hong recorded intracellularly from two projection neurons in the T glomerulus. As you would expect, they both respond when he stimulated with component A. So in stimulating the input with component A, both cells responded, as you'd expect, and there was a low degree of coincident firing between the two cells. That, and coincidence in this case means action potentials that are within 3 to 5 milliseconds of each other, so basically occurring at the same time in the two cells. But when he stimulated with the mixture, remember this component drives inhibition from the adjacent glomerulus, when he stimulated with the mixture, that coincident firing of the two cells was significantly increased. Significantly enough that Nature Neuroscience was willing to publish it. So the case was persuasive, I think. So we talked about this, we thought, you know, maybe that's it. coincident firing of principal cells from the glomeruli might be a way of encoding A in the context of B and B in the context of A. So we add that as a possible coding mechanism. But if it's really happening, we should be able to look in the targets of those output cells, which are over here in the lateral protocerebrum. This is looking at the brain from the top down and just a cartoon of the output pathways from the cells in the antennal lobe. All of them project over here to this lateral protocerebrum and different olfactory foci there. If, in fact, the coincident firing is an important mechanism, there should be coincidence detection by neurons over there in the target region. Now, Hong has tried to find that and has had preliminary tantalizing evidence, but never have been able to get proof of coincidence detection. So that's a challenge to those of you sitting out there who want to push electrodes. This is something really worthy of additional work. But now I want to say something about what happens after the information reaches the lateral protocerebrum, because that's not the end of the story. Pheromone is going to affect the flight motor. It's going to affect the behavior of the animal. So the information somehow has to make its way to the thorax, where the musculature for flight is controlled, and that's not going to get there just by going to the lateral protocerebrum. We had a coworker some years ago, a wonderful Japanese postdoc, named Ryohei Kanzaki. There's Ryohei. He did a series of experiments that were, I think, really stunning. He was interested in cells higher up in the brain, like this one. This is a cell that innervates on both sides of the brain a structure called the lateral accessory lobe. Those are here shown in red. Now, the lateral protocerebrum that we were just talking about is over here. These lateral accessory lobes are structures that were well known, but we didn't know what their function was in olfactory information processing. So this is a cell he recorded from and then dye injected. And the recordings are down here. This is, to me, still a stunning result. When he stimulated the antenna with just pulses of clean air, there was no effect on the background firing of this cell. When he stimulated with just a wash of the pheromone gland of a female, there was a gradual increase of firing till this cell really kind of got very excited, but it was slow to develop. When he stimulated with component A alone, no effect on background firing. When he stimulated with B alone, no effect. But look at this. When he used the synthetic A plus B 2-to-1 mixture and he stimulated the antenna, the cell went berserk. We call that long-lasting excitation. That's an understatement. So it ramped up, became more dramatic than this, probably because of the weaker stimulus that we were able to get by washing the pheromone gland. Here we had a pretty strong, pure stimulus. This went on for upwards of a second, which is a very long time. And it's fascinating to see because that activity is being conveyed by this cell down into the thorax. So it's a good candidate for being a cell that's influencing the flight motor in the thorax. And it's kind of what you'd expect if you think about the counter-turning motor pattern of an anemotactic flight in a moth. You want something that's like a thumb on a switch that's going to sustain elements of the flight behavior until the next pulse of pheromone comes along. This cell is a really good candidate to do that. But again, it's a challenge for people out there that might want to work in this field. Go after that and figure out if that's really what the cells are responsible for. Okay, so this just summarizes some of Ryohei's work. So the input from the pheromone receptors in the antenna comes here to the lateral protocerebrum and then has inputs onto a number of different cell types in the central, more central regions of the brain, including the one you just saw that project contralaterally to the lateral accessory lobe and then down through the nerve cord. Okay, Now, let's move ahead, because we've talked about pheromone, but if this coincidence idea is right, it should work for other mixtures that are behaviorally important, where we have an odor object that's maybe more complicated. So we then turn to foraging and the interactions of Manduca with Datura. So if the coincidence hypothesis is correct, it ought to work there too. So here comes the story of Jeff Riffle, a terrific postdoc that was in our lab. He's now a professor at University of Washington in Seattle. Jeff was fearless and did wonderful things. So here's just a quick summary of what he did. He went out in the field and trapped volatiles from flowers of Datura growing out in the desert. adsorbed them onto little cartridges, took it into the lab, desorbed it into a GC, identified a lot of compounds. Basically, he found more than 60 volatiles in the headspace over a datura flower. And the question then is, well, the behavior of the moth orienting to the flower, does that depend on those 60 compounds? Is it like the pheromone, where maybe a subset of those compounds are important? So we asked the question, which datura flora volatiles are necessary and sufficient to attract Manduca for nectar feeding to a flower? What's the essential minimal odor object? So we hypothesized, kind of crazily, that there would be antennal lobe projection neurons that respond selectively to components of that mixture if those components are really the critical ones. So Jeff went after that. It's a daunting prospect. But he used a technique that I can only very sketchily outline here. But if you're interested, it's all published. What he did was to inject the mixture into a GC, run it through the GC, split the stream here so that we could visualize the peaks coming off the GC through an FID. And then at the same time, those peaks are being delivered into an airstream to an antenna. While he's recording not only from the antenna, so it's GC-EAD, but he's also recording from the brain. As far as we knew, that wasn't something others had done before, to use the brain of a live insect as a detector on a GC. He did that with a multi-electrode array that allowed him to record from quite a few neurons all at once. That helped take a big, demanding project and make it tractable. And to make a long story short, what he found was neurons that, by the basis of their waveform properties, were probably projection neurons in that antenna lobe that he was using as a detector, that were selectively responsive to 9 of the more than 60 compounds in the headspace of the flowers. So then again, you know, drinking beer one afternoon, we said, well, maybe those 9 are the essential odor object. So Jeff proceeded to test that idea. The way that was done was to use a laboratory wind tunnel with flowers made of paper. These are just surrogate flowers. Dope them with various mixtures from those 9 compounds, and in the wind tunnel, test the response of flying moths. So this is just a flight path of a moth that was launched down here to a flower that was carrying the full 9 components. And you see that moth, and the wind is going from right to left, the moth locked onto that plume and went right to the flower, and here you see a moth approaching the paper flower and feeding. This could be sugar water down here. They'll do this even if there isn't sugar water, because they hope there is. But we usually like to reward them with some sugar water. So when they fly properly in the plume, approach the flower, and feed, we figure they think that's a datura flower. When they don't think it's an appropriate flower, even though they can see it, they fly randomly in the plume, in the moving airstream, and show no interest in the flower. So that's a very clear positive and negative behavioral result. Well, now this looks complicated, but it's not as bad as it looks. What Jeff did then was to test the 9 components and compare their effect in the blend proportions that they exist in the floral headspace with the response to the whole floral scent of more than 60. And what you see here is for the entire 60 volatiles, about 60 or 62% of the moths Jeff tested did the whole thing. They locked onto the plume, flew up, approached the flower, and attempted to feed. So that's the behavior standard for the actual floral scent. Now, when he tested the 9 volatiles, he got something that wasn't statistically different from that. When he tested 5, not statistically different. 4, he got all the way down to 3 of those compounds, which were these 3, the 2 aromatics, benzaldehyde and benzyl alcohol, and linalool. Here, we were testing just racemic linalool. That mixture was as good as the entire floral scent in triggering and sustaining this behavior in the moths. So we proceeded then to think, well, that is the essential odor object. If Jeff tested other mixtures from this set of components that didn't include those 3, they gave very substandard behavioral responses. So we figure you've got to have those 3. And I should say, just in passing, in case anyone's interested, that when plus linalool is used here, in place of the racemic linalool, it's as effective. So it may well be that it's the plus, but it seems that using the racemic mixture is as good. The plants emit both. Okay, so that's the idea. Now the question is, what about coincident firing? If that odor object is encoded in the brain the way the pheromone blend was encoded, we should see coincident firing. And I've just summarized something complicated as simply as I could. Here are the various mixtures down to the three-component mixture. You get the complete behavior with all of those, as I showed you. And all of those evoke a greatly enhanced coincident firing among neurons that Jeff detected that were tuned to these components, as compared with just controls or the behaviorally ineffective mixtures that did not evoke that greatly enhanced coincidence. So it's a lot like what we saw with pheromone. I'm just not showing you the actual data because of time. So this is a nice support, at least a step of support, for the coincident firing hypothesis, and we're quite excited about this. It's time for others to carry on with this because my time is pretty much up, but I think it's a wonderful beginning of what probably is going to be a terrific story. This is the conclusion slide. I'm not going to read it because I'm out of time, but I do have a couple other things I want to say. Notice that we took the conditional out of this. We now are pretty confident that coincident firing is an important coding mechanism. I've talked to you now about the olfactory pathway in Manduca from the receptors in the antenna through the glomeruli in the antennal lobe over here to the lateral protocerebrum. There's a lot more here that we didn't talk about, the mushroom bodies, the feedback circuitry. It's a rich and wonderful playground for someone interested in sensory neurobiology and behavior of insects. And a lot of good people now are studying various aspects of this olfactory system in various insect taxa. It's wonderful, because when I started, there were only a handful of people in the world who cared at all about it. And I must tell you that when I started out, I was told by review groups at NIH that, doesn't this young man know that you can't record from nerve cells in an insect brain? That's the way it was when we began. I'm happy that we proved them wrong. That isn't the only harsh input I've had, though, and I'll say a word about that in a moment. I just want to mention this, and I haven't got time to talk about it, but the reference is down here. Martin, Josh Martin et al., this is the Progress in Neurobiology in 2011. We wrote a review looking at four of the main insect model systems used to study olfactory information processing. Locusts, bees, honeybees, Drosophila, and moths. And talked about the really striking differences that are found in those olfactory systems. It isn't right to think that if you've understood the olfactory system in Manduca or Drosophila, you understand olfaction in insects. These systems are significantly different. And we talk about those differences in that review and speculate about their significance. It's a fascinating subject and shouldn't be surprising to any biologist who understands how remote the relationships among these insects are, how derived some of those species are, how different their interactions with their ecosystem are, how different their behaviors are, and so forth. But there are basic principles that I think do apply very broadly, and I've tried to highlight some of those tonight. Okay, now here comes my final little rant. All through my career, I've had people come after me because I don't live in an entomological environment, or I haven't always. I have people in medical school where I worked and other places say, well, this is all very well and good, but why do you work on a bug? Why don't you work on an important animal? Why don't you study olfaction in mice or dogs or something significant? You can't imagine how much of that I've gotten in my life. So I started 10 years ago ending seminars with a little statement or two about why this is important to do. This audience doesn't really need it, but I'm going to do a little version of it anyway. I've tried to show you tonight that, first, these are wonderful model systems. I don't really like that term, but I'll use it. That is to say, if you want to understand fundamental principles of olfaction, an insect olfactory system is at least as good as any other to learn about fundamental principles. And I think some of the ones that we've uncovered in Manduca apply very broadly, like the chemotopic organization of glomeruli and so forth. And we take advantage of Croak's principle. This is something that V.B. Wigglesworth was very proudly an exponent of too. That is the idea that in nature, there's going to be a system or an experimental preparation in which you can most conveniently and powerfully study a phenomenon or a process of interest. Well, these olfactory systems are wonderful for learning about olfaction in general, just without reference to the fact that it's an insect. But then we get to the fact that they're insects. And unlike laboratory mice and so forth, these are important creatures, as all of you know very well. I mean, they destroy crops. They destroy the crops for which we, from which we get food, fiber, and fuel. They destroy stored food products. They're huge destructors of human food supply worldwide. They're vectors of diseases, of bacterial, viral, and parasitic diseases. You all know that very well. In fact, it's arguable if you add up all the diseases of humans that are vectored by blood-sucking insects, it's the biggest health problem of humans in the world. And people are very stressed right now, worrying about arboviral diseases spread by Aedes mosquitoes, for good reason. They're also not all bad. I mean, we know that insects do great things, too. I mean, we get lots of free pollination services from insects, bees, but not only bees. They give us products that we care about, like honey and silk and so forth. And some of them are parasitoids that prey on harmful organisms. So we get yin and yang from insects. And the thing that's so important, and the reason I'm stressing this now, is that all of these behaviors depend more or less on olfaction. So I have actually had the experience of speaking to an audience like this, full of white coats and stethoscopes, where I said, if you really care about human health, you'd study insect olfaction. I had some people come up to me afterwards and say, that was amazing. Nobody ever said that before. Now, I like to end with this little bit, which is that they're worth studying just because they're the most speciose and successful fauna on the planet. It's good to understand, how do they do so well in the terrible mess we've made of this planet? They were doing very well before we came along, and they'll be here when we're gone. I'm sure May has written articles about that. They're beautiful as inspirations for biologically inspired engineered devices like robots. And I wish I could talk about that now because it's a topic we've worked on too. So robots and biobots based on insects are amazing. And finally, I tell people, they're just the most fascinating and beautiful creatures next to my wife that I know. Now, I hope talking about Manduka and its sense of smell has given you an appreciation not only of how bugs smell, but also of how we smell and how we enjoy scents that matter to us. And very finally, I promise my very last slide, I want to do a little homage to people who've made a huge difference to me in my career. These are people that taught me what I know about insects that sustain my enthusiasm through difficult times. And I'm terribly indebted to every one of them. And it's a great place to express that appreciation because I think probably many of them are known, at least by name, in this audience. Reg Chapman, who wrote the insect textbook that I first learned about insects from, and who was a next door colleague of mine in the lab until he passed away. Vince Dettier, who was a dear friend and I taught courses with him. He was again an inspiration. Tom Eisner, the one and only Tom Eisner, the most passionate, amazing biologist I've ever known. Rachel Galoon, the inimitable Rachel Galoon. She gave me my first appreciation of blood-sucking arthropods and led to work we've done on kissing bugs. Franz Huber, just turned 90 last year, one of the world's most eminent neuroethologists who really stimulated my interest in neuroethology, the neural basis of natural behavior. John Law, the person I worked with when I was a sophomore in college and was my first research experience and with whom I published my first paper. He was a bacterial biochemist who, the minute he got tenure, gave up bacteria and went to work on insects. And he told me he'd always wanted to do that, but he knew he wouldn't get tenure if he worked on insects. But he spent the rest of his career, as you probably know, working on insects. Miriam Rothschild, who was one of my favorite people, and I'm sure John Pickett will appreciate that too. She was really an irresistible force of nature who would parade up to one in moon boots and with her bandana over her head and tell you what your next experiment had to be. Has that ever happened to you? And I have to give her credit that, or blame her, that she's the person who nominated me for a fellowship in the Royal Entomological Society. I'm very honored by that. Dietz Schneider, I've already mentioned. Such a wonderful person and the man who put insect olfaction on the agenda. Carol Williams, again, if anyone who ever met Carol knows that he too was a force of nature and an amazing inspiration and the mentor to Lynn Ritterford and indirectly to Jim Truman, who gave me my first Manduca, and also Fotis Kafatos. And finally, Ed Wilson. I first met Ed when he was a young assistant professor and nobody had ever heard of him. And he taught me how beautiful ants are. And of course, little did I know that 50 years later, he'd be one of the most eminent biologists, scientists on planet Earth. It's wonderful to see an entomologist reach the absolute pinnacle. And these people in this slide not only did that, but they made a big difference to me and my career, and I want to thank them. And I want to thank you for hanging with me. Thank you so much.
Gold!
You're still a photographer.
There's a photographer here somewhere.
We're just going to have to stand here while the photographer comes back. He should be here. But while we're doing that, I'm just going to indulge just a few more moments. John, just stay there for a few moments, because we have one more function, and that is to honor another distinguished American entomologist. Yesterday, we concluded a summit which was organized by the American Society of Entomology, and it involved people from entomological societies around the world joining together to think about grand challenges for entomology. And it's really very important that we do work together. And we'd like to honour somebody by honorary fellowship of the Royal Entomological Society, who's a great entomologist in extension as well as in research from Oklahoma State. And we'd also like to honour him because of his immense efforts as various service functions within the Entomological Society of America. His name is Phil Mulder. Please. Just let me show you. And you'll notice I'm not giving him anything because he's already got it and we can't use it tonight because he's put it on his wall already. Phil, it's a great honor to have you in a society that was founded by Charles Darwin and Russell Wallace, of course, and included Miriam Rothschild. Phil, thank you very much and congratulations.
Thank you, John. Thank you.
Shaking hands.
Oh, that's normal.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, yeah. Oh, and you're holding it that way.
That's, yeah. Yeah, great.
You can
great.
Tell I'm not accustomed to
yeah,
that.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm sorry, I couldn't see you.
I can't